Hi, this is Professor Jamie Chan at California State University, Long Beach. In this video lesson today, we'll look at how to use zeros to graph polynomial functions. We're going to introduce some terminology using this following picture. Let's start with the definition of zero. If f is a polynomial function, then x equals c is called a zero of f if f of c is equal to zero. X equals c is also known as the x-intercept of f. It is obtained via solving the equation f of x equals x minus c times some other quotient q of x equal to 0, which means that x minus c is a factor for the function f. In this picture, I would call x equals negative 3 a 0 for the polynomial function f. X equals 2 is also a 0. X equals 5 is also a 0. If these are zeros of the polynomial function f of x, that means f of x must have x minus c as factors, which means it must have factor x plus 3, x minus 2, and x minus 5. It should look something like this, maybe potentially multiplied by another quotient, q of x. It also could potentially have a different constant that sits in front of them. A very interesting thing to observe here is that the graph between two successive zeros of f lies entirely above or below the x-axis. For example, in between the zero negative 3 and 2, we notice that the graph lies entirely above the x-axis. Between the two successive zeros of 2 and 5, the graph lies entirely below the x-axis. Knowing this information, along with the knowledge of the end behavior, helps us to sketch the graph of polynomials. Next, I'm going to show you a step-by-step process of sketching the graph of a polynomial using the zeros. Here, I want to sketch the graph of f of x equals x cubed plus 3x squared minus 4x minus 12. Step one is to factor the polynomial to find all of its real zeros, meaning the x-intercepts. To factor, we notice that there are four terms in this polynomial, which tells us that we should use the method of grouping. I will group x cubed with 3x squared because they both share an x squared term. I will group 4x and 12 because they both share a 4. When I group the 4x and the 12, I'm going to pull out a negative sign. I have 4x plus 12. Proceed by factoring each group. First group, I have x squared as a common term. If I pull that out, I'm left with x plus 3. The second group, I can pull out a 4. Negatives is already there, so when I pull out a 4, I didn't really have to change signs. This will leave me with x plus 3. Notice that in order to proceed forward, these two factors need to look exactly the same anyways. If they're not the same, that means you either factored wrong, or this was the wrong grouping to start it with. Proceed, I notice that there's a common factor of x plus 3 between the two terms. I pull that out and I have leftover x squared from the first term and the minus 4 from the second term. I then notice that this is a difference of 2 squared, so I can factor that further into x plus 2 and x minus 2. To finish, I get 3 factors, x plus 3, x plus 2, and x minus 2. This tells me that zeros are negative 3, negative 2, and 2. This also tells me that this function has the x-intercepts at x equals 2, negative 2, and negative 3. So we know for sure the graph intersects the x-axis at those points, which means that the function value at those points should be 0. The question becomes, what happens to the function value in between those zeros? We know from before, in between each successive zeros, the function should lie entirely above or below the x-axis. So we can use a test point in between those zeros to figure out whether the function lies above or below the x-axis. In particular, when we choose the test point, we want to include the y-intercept, that is when x is equal to 0, for convenience. Start by drawing the real number line, and clearly label from left to right all of our zeros. In this case, it would be negative 3, negative 2, and 2. If this was our hypothetical x-axis, the graph would have y value equal to 0 exactly at those x locations. And that's also why these points are called the zeros, because they have 0 function value. Then pick test points on each interval. Let's pick negative 4 on this first interval, negative 2.5 on this second interval, 0 on this third interval. We have to pick 0 because this is exactly where the y-intercept is. pick 3 on this last interval. Remember, the function behavior is such that it lies entirely above or below the x-axis on each of those intervals. Having tested just one point on that interval would tell us the entire story about what happens on that interval. Then figure out the sine of the function on each of those test points. To do that, we're going to use our factor form, which is right here. Do not want to use the original polynomial function because it requires a lot of calculation. The factor form tells us right away whether or not the result is positive or negative. For example, if we start with the first test point, negative 4, if I were to put negative 4 in place for x, I would expect to have a negative quantity out of the first factor because negative 4 plus 3 is negative 1. So I would get a negative out of that first factor. A negative 4 in the second quantity or factor here would then produce a negative quantity as well. A negative 4 in the third factor would also create a negative quantity. If I now multiply 3 negative quantities, I would expect to get a negative result out of that. This allows me to come back and put a negative sign down here below the test point negative 4. Then proceed with the next test point of negative 2.5. This will give me a positive first quantity, a negative second quantity, and a negative third quantity. Altogether, this will produce a positive quantity because two negatives turns into a positive, and a positive times a positive is a positive. So I can come back and put a positive sign below my test point negative 2.5. For the test point of 0, I will get positive, positive, and negative, which overall gives me a negative quantity. Now for my last test point, 3, I would get positive, positive, and positive, which is an overall positive quantity. This means that over on this first interval, from negative infinity all the way up to negative 3, I would expect to see my graph dipping below the x-axis. Over on the next interval, between negative 3 to negative 2, my graph should live above the x-axis. In between negative 2 to 2, my graph should then dip below the x-axis, and similarly, from 2 and on to infinity, it should be above the x-axis. The leftmost test point and the rightmost test point kind of tells us about the end behavior as well. The leftmost test point here tells us that the y goes to the negative infinity as x goes to negative infinity, and y goes to the positive infinity as x goes to the positive infinity. But we can actually confirm that with our end behavior knowledge. By looking at the dominating term of the polynomial, which is x cubed here, it should follow the same behavior of the x cubed function, which looks like this. And that is exactly matching with the information that we've gotten from our test points, step 2. Now to finish, we're going to plot a few additional points to try to make the graph as smoothly as possible. Once we have all those information from the previous steps, we can then eventually sketch. To this end, we're going to do a table of values. In particular, we're going to include all of the zeros and the test points function values. Starting from the leftmost test point, negative 4, put this in your calculator, it would return a negative 12 function value. Negative 3 is one of our zeros, which means that its function value should be 0. Negative 2.5 is our next test point. Its function value is 0.625. And as you're putting in the function value, you should confirm that whether or not the function value matches with the sign that you obtained in step 2. For example, negative 4 has the function value of negative 12, which is negative, and that matches with the negative sign that we got. The next 0 is negative 2, which has the function value of 0. Next test point is 0, which has function value negative 12. 0 at 2, function value 0. Next test point 3 has the function value of 30. These points should be enough to help us sketch the polynomial. Let's try it. We'll first start finding my zeros. That would be negative 3, negative 2, and positive 2. Know for sure if the graph intersects the x-axis at those points, because these are my x-intercepts. I will also try to find my y-intercept as well, and that is when x value is 0. The y-intercept has the value of negative 12. We'll use the rest of the test points from my table values to figure out additional points. For example, negative 4, negative 12. Another example would be negative 2.5, 0.625. at x equals 3, I have a function value of 30. 30 is kind of way off of the chart here. I'm just going to pretend that this is about 30 right there. You don't need to be precise. This is a sketch. The goal is to get a shape of the polynomial is not to be as precise in your drawing as possible. I'm also going to remind myself the end behaviors here. As x goes to the positive infinity, my function should then go to the positive infinity in the y value. As x goes to negative infinity, the function should go to the negative infinity in terms of its y value as well. Now I think I'm ready to sketch. Start from the left end and try to connect all the points. Remember to put arrows on both ends because of the end behavior. That's it.